Philippine Police and the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. They met yesterday. They now agreed to have closer coordination. That's amid the recent spate of killings of lawyers, prosecutors, and even judges here in the country. IBP President Domingo Cayosa now joins us on the program. Attorney Cayosa, welcome to the program and thank you for joining us today.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Magandang hapon sa mga viewers.
Aside from that, I'm not sure if you saw the tweets or if you were informed about these tarpaulin, there was a tarpaulin that was put up and basically red-tagged the judge responsible for acquitting a journalist and a labor leader. Some cost-oriented groups have called it tarpaulin terrorism. What would you call it?
Well, we don't label it any way, but what is clear is that our local chapter, the IBP Pasig Rizal chapter, when we learned about this, we coordinated with them and they requested the local authorities to take down the tarpaulin. And that was done immediately. We are raising these concerns with the proper authorities so that they can investigate who placed the tarpaulin in the first place, because it is unfair if we include in the red tagging or in the political fights our honorable judges. They should be allowed to fairly decide on cases brought before them without pressure, without labeling, and without intimidation.
Attorney Cayosa, you know, this has been the history. First they went after drug addicts, then activists, then lawyers, now judges. What do you think is the effect of this latest attack on the legal community?
Well, it is inevitable that it causes concern, fear, and terror on some of our members. It hinders the progress of the rule of law and the legal processes. And it is not good for our campaign to have speedy justice. When lawyers or judges or prosecutors hesitate to do their professional duty because of fear, threat, intimidation, or red tagging, then the country as a whole, our justice system suffers. We don't want that happening. We have enough issues about the rule of law, about due process in this country, and we don't want to add delay to that. And we are imploring and calling on everyone to do their share. And we're very thankful that the top management of the Philippine National Police have categorically stated in our meeting and the joint statement that they will not tolerate these shortcuts and that they will investigate thoroughly this incident so that we will know who are behind them and that they're made to account for these things.
Yeah, tell us about the meeting, more about the meeting that happened yesterday. Were they really as welcoming? And this partnership now, this coordination between your organization and theirs, when do we see the soonest effect of this partnership?
Well, we've seen practical effects already. So far, the latest killings of lawyers, because of the closer coordination between our chapters and the local police and the national leadership of IBP and the national leadership of PNP, it helped greatly in identifying the suspects, arresting them, and charging them before our courts of law. The other one, of course, is because we have now these mechanisms to communicate, we get from the top brass of PNP categorical statements that they will not tolerate any shortcuts, any breach of the rule of law and due process. And we've also seen quite recently more decisive action against those in their ranks who break the law or who do shortcuts. Of course, there are still many other unsolved and uninvestigated cases. We hope that eventually they will get to them.
Attorney Cayosa, what gives you confidence in this partnership with the Philippine National Police, considering that their organization is also facing a lot of allegations about human rights abuses, that they have sort of evolved from being protectors of the people to abusers of human rights? Go ahead, Attorney Cayosa.
This partnership is not the only approach that we are taking. We are doing many other things totally within our control. But we would like to believe that we are dealing with fellow professionals. We're professional lawyers. They're professional law and police officers. And just like any organization, we have the good guys and a few bad guys. So if we don't talk, if we don't coordinate, what will happen? It will get worse. So we believe that opening lines of communication, exchanging information, and working together so that we can move the wheels of justice much faster is another approach that can work. Mm-hmm. It is not 100% solution to the problems that we face, but it surely helps a lot. It also assures our membership, the lawyers, the judges, and everybody else, that we are talking with those who have command of the whole PNP. And we're very thankful also to them for very categorical statement nowadays about their willingness and determination to stop this culture of impunity and any shortcut of the rule of law and due process.
Putting the spotlight now on the IBP, the organization which you represent, it's facing a lot of issues too. First and foremost, the so-called factories of search warrants. How is the IBP addressing this? What is your opinion regarding this?
Well, we've made a statement about that. We quoted one other law group, a much smaller law group, which came out a few weeks ago about that statement. So we look at it as an allegation. We also had a meeting with the Association of Judges, the three groups of judges all over the country, and we discussed this. And that's why we also share their view that in most cases, these judges really examine the evidence. And if you look at the statistics, even these judges against whom these allegations are made or suspicions are made, if you look at the statistics, many of the applications were denied by them. So they're not perfect. Sometimes there might be lapses. There might be misappreciation of the evidence and the quantum of evidence that they would require for them to issue warrants of arrest or warrants or search warrants. But if you look at the overall statistics, many of these applications are denied. So they're now in a predicament, in a dilemma, because if they grant the requested warrants, the other side complains. If they don't grant it, the other side complains. But that is the unique dilemma of our judges. That's why IBP, they being our members, is calling on the public and all the sides, please allow them to do their jobs properly. If you want your cases or your causes to be favorably acted upon, please give them the evidence and the truth so that they can do their jobs much better and much faster. Please don't target them.
Yeah, I also want to bring this question in because it was a discussion, I think, middle of yesterday about how the Supreme Court as well has discussed the use of body cameras in issuing these search warrants. What do you think about that? What is the IBP's position regarding that?
We're very thankful that yesterday the Honorable Supreme Court, the justices of the Honorable Supreme Court, started considering a proposal that IBP made public about a few days ago. And this is not unique to us. There are also similar proposals. What we said a few days ago was if the Honorable Court could consider requiring the use of body cameras for those law enforcement agencies or personnel that they deputize to serve their writs, their warrants of arrest or search warrants. Because we know that a few years ago, when this EJK controversy came up, the government bought a few thousands of these body cameras. They were tested, but they were not used. Mm-mm. But now that we are suggesting that they use these body cameras for those who serve search warrants or arrest warrants so that both parties are protected, the subjects of these warrants and those who serve them, so that nobody can make up stories. So it is a very practical suggestion. We're very thankful that the Supreme Court has acted on it. They're now deliberating the details and how they can do it.
talking about the Supreme Court. Before we got you on air, we had our correspondent Mike Navalio reporting to us about how the UP law faculty is now appealing to the Supreme Court, basically to protect its own. May I ask you, Attorney Cayosa, how do you think the Supreme Court can protect its own, considering the situation now wherein lawyers and judges are being killed?
Well, first, we welcome the effort of many other groups echoing the earlier letters and calls by IBP for protection of lawyers and all those who work in the justice sector. Secondly, the Supreme Court and the judges can best protect themselves by the good decisions that they make and the timely decisions that they make. But on a practical level, I think they're also exploring many different ways. For one, we know and we're supporting the proposal of the Supreme Court for judicial marshals to secure the judicial processes and the officers of the court. We support that in Congress. The Supreme Court has also acted on our suggestion request that the judges inventory all these cases pending before them involving attacks or killing of lawyers, fiscals, and judges, so that we will know what has happened to them, why are they languishing in the courts, and what else can we do to expedite the resolution of these criminal cases. So these are practical things that the Honorable Supreme Court is doing. We are also suggesting, if possible for it, the Supreme Court, to review the rule allowing a select number of judges in Metro Manila to issue warrants enforceable all over the country. This rule was a new rule in 2004. Traditionally, warrants of arrest were issued, applied for and issued by the regional trial courts in the provinces where they operate or in the regions where they have jurisdiction. But because of the leakages of information, and this is also a practical problem, before the warrants could be served, sometimes the information goes to the subject of this warrant. So they escape, they disappear, etc. And that's why in 2004, they developed this new rule. But because of all of these concerns about the service of warrants, we are proposing that perhaps it's timely for the Honorable Supreme Court to consider giving this back to the trial courts that have better appreciation of the circumstances and more intimate knowledge of the local reality so that they can truly ask searching questions from the applicants before they issue the warrants.
As a final question, Attorney Cayosa, do you think that the Supreme Court will be dynamic enough in this day and age to address all these concerns and be relevant?
Well, we hope that they would be. We trust that they would be. Please understand that it is a collegial body of 15 justices. They have their own processes. Perhaps IBP, being a private organization, and many other smaller groups can act faster. But we have to respect their processes. The other thing also is they are the court of last resort. So they have to study all the legal repercussions and the details before they come up with the rules or the measures that will adapt. So we understand that. But we are thankful that they're acting on this because our judges, everyone who works in the justice sector, they must be protected.
Attorney Domingo Cayosa, President of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines, always a pleasure talking to you. You keep safe. Take care.
Thank you. Good afternoon.